Good morning. So as Vijay introduced, I am Rajshekar. So this is my first time in JS4 Pune, and this is my first time in Pune also. So I have been in Mumbai for I think 5 years, but for Pune I am coming here for the first time. So my Hindi is very bad also, and when I went into Mumbai for the first time for my job, so initially I learned a couple of sentences in Marathi. So the first sentence I learned is, I don't know if I pronounce it correctly, Gatirodhak Pude Aay. So, okay. So, let's forget about my Marathi proficiency. Let's talk about code mods. Okay. In this talk, we're going to discuss about a new type of tooling called code mods, which will fundamentally bring a change in the way you do large scale migrations or refactorings with your code base. I work for a company called Freshworks as a front-end developer. Freshworks provides simple and innovative SaaS products for the CRM business for all kinds. So if you want to know more about Freshworks, come talk to me later of the session. Once again, hi, I'm Rajshekar on GitHub and Rajshekar_C on Twitter. So if you have any questions around the code mod topic or anything, you can shoot me in Twitter. My DMs are open. So let's talk, set the stage first. Okay, so before diving into the topic, so let's talk about paradigm shift. What do you mean by a paradigm? Paradigm is like a lens, an imaginary lens or a conceptual lens through which all the information you perceive gets filtered through. Paradigm shift is an important change that usually happens in the way that is replaced by a new and different way of doing something, right? So let's see some examples from history and science to understand the concept better. Let's talk about the geocentric theory. So geocentric theory was put forward by Ptolemy, which says the Earth was the center of the universe. So Ptolemy's Earth-centered model had lasted without serious challenge for 1500 years. Then in 1543, Copernicus put forward a new theory called heliocentric theory, which says the sun was the center of the universe, not the Earth. Okay. So this change in mental model, this change in understanding led ultimately to the classification of new planets, the reclassification of moon as a satellite rather than a planet, and a different understanding of mankind's place in the universe. So if you look at large scale code base migrations from the same perspective, we still have a lot of old ideas and mental models to which we are sticking with for a very long time. Let's see one by one. So the first one is rejects pattern matching. Whenever you think about making changes to code, you know, naturally you tend towards rejects, right, with pattern matching. So you find and replace, your text editors or code editors find and replace underneath works with regular expressions, I guess. And then you always think about manual grunt work for doing large scale changes, right? And then you do ad hoc changes every time. And this ultimately led to breaking changes, right? So you are not confident when you make changes with large scale code bases, when you are doing upgrades or migrations. So how do we address these things? So let's take a simple example where your regex might not work. So this is a simple code. This is like kind of hello world example for code mods or why regex might not be suitable for large scale changes. I have a variable hello world and a function say hello, console log hello world. I want to replace the variable name hello with world. It's a simple change. So after applying a regex here, so now you can see the output. The hello world has been replaced with world all over. Right? So this is not what we wanted. We just wanted to change the variable name, not anything else. Okay. So the natural tendency in problem solving is that you pick the first solution that comes to mind and run with it. The problem here is you may either run off a cliff or into a worse problem than you started with. So regular expressions often suffer from a limitation that they don't work with context anymore. Like they are not able to differentiate between a variable name, a function name, or a string literal. So context matters a lot in these areas. So let's see some other examples where your regexes might not be suitable. If you are upgrading to new language syntax features like ECMAScript 6, 7 or 8, something like that. Let's say for example, take arrow functions. So before arrow functions, we used to do this, we assign this to a variable and use it inside the function context. But after arrow functions, we don't have to do all those things because arrow functions have the context. And rejects might not solve the cases here because you are deleting code, you are wrapping code, you are replacing something. Everything works with context and scope. Let's see one more example with Vue.js upgrades. If you are upgrading from Vue 1x2.0, the attached callback lifecycle has been renamed to mounted, and you also have to wrap everything inside it with a mixtick function, right? So now you know that the regex patterns are not suitable for making last kill changes because you always miss something when you work with regexes. So let's talk about the manual grunt work part. So how do you increase throughput in a large scale migration work, large task which will take weeks or months like this? What conventional wisdom tells us that there are only two ways to do that: get faster people to do the work or get more people to do the work. But in reality, getting faster people is more of a subjective thing and it always doesn't work out. And getting more people to a project seems like a classic mistake in software development, right? So the most sensible thing to do here is to automate the task. So it's time to shift paradigms. So let's see how we can address the old paradigms which we were talking before, how we can bring in new paradigms so that we can scale our migration tasks. So this is where CodeMods comes into the picture. CodeMods is short for code modifications. It actually works with something called AST transformations. They can be automated and they can be reusable. CodeMod is a tool or library that assists you with large scale refactoring or code bases. It was developed by Facebook and later open sourced it. So what is AST transformations? So let's first paradigm shift from regex pattern match to AST transform. What do you mean by an AST? An AST is an abstract syntax tree, which is just a tree representation of your source code, right? So the ASTs are primarily used by compilers to do syntax analysis, semantic analysis, consistency checking, and it's also used to generate optimized code. So how your compilers create AST? It undergoes a series of stages like lexical analysis, syntax analysis. At the end of syntax analysis stage, you get the AST. Let's see what is there happening in lexical analysis and these kind of stages. In lexical analysis, there is something called the scanner, which scans your code and converts it into a list of tokens. As you can see here, you have a function, hello world, console log. So all these individual things has been converted into tokens. Even your punctuations and delimiters are also converted into tokens. In the next stage, the parser takes the tokens and constructs a tree data structure. Okay, so this is your abstract syntax tree. So it starts with program, body, and function declaration, identifier. Inside the function declaration body, you have block statement and inside all this stuff. So if you're like me or someone who don't get ASTs the first time, so I'll give you a simple analogy. Think about it like a DOM of your web page. You know DOM, right? Document Object Model. It's nothing but the tree representation of your HTML markup. So the AST is similar to that, it's tree representation of your source code, right? So how AST transforms really work? So there is a stage called parsing stage, which will take the code and convert it into an abstract syntax tree. We saw that earlier, right? And then you manipulate the nodes in the abstract syntax tree. And then you create a new node or update or delete node. You modify the tree and you print back the tree by generating the code from it and you get the modified code. So this is how AST transforms work at a very high level. So we'll see a tool called AST Explorer, which works with your AST. So through AST Explorer, you can visualize your ASTs and you can inspect the nodes and stuff. So this is a sample code I showed you. So the variable declaration and function declaration. At the right, you have the AST. It is represented in JSON annotation. You have objects. You have file, program, and body. Under body, you have two types of nodes, variable declaration and function declaration. Under variable declaration, you have a type, the node type is variable declaration, and it has declarations, which is an array of objects. And again, it's a node, variable declarator. So why it's an array of objects is that it's identified by both identifier and literal, because you can have multiple declarations within a single statement. I'll see an example. If I say another declaration, you get two variable declarators here. So two variable declarators can be part of a single variable declaration. And then function declaration is identified by a node type function declaration. And inside it, you have the identifier, which is the name of your function. identified by the name, and you have params, which is an array of objects. You can have multiple params, so that's why it is an array. So you have identifiers, like which is identified type A, name, and inside the function body you have a block statement. So which is an expression statement. Your console log is an expression statement, which is itself a call expression with the member expression as the callee. Your object is identified by console and the property is the log. So anything comes with dot something is a member expression in AST spec. Okay. So you have the arguments here identified for the caller expression. So this is about AST Explorer. So you have seen what AST is, right? What it can be capable of. So where they are actually making use of ASTs. So simply put, it is used everywhere in your JavaScript ecosystem of tools and libraries. It is used by Babel, ESLint, your Webpack, Parcel, so your bundlers, so your linters, everything makes use of ASTs for their. And then the second paradigm shift I was talking about is from manual grunt work to automation. How you can automate these changes. So there is a tool for that which is called JS Code Shift. It is again created by Facebook by Felix Kling. It is made up of two things. One is called the runner, which is actually a CLI, command line interface tool. And the second one is the wrapper, which is a wrapper around a library called recast. So the CLI tool, you have to install it with the npm package, npm install JS Code Shift, and you can run it with a parameter passing transform, where you give the transformation logic for your AST nodes. So how do you want to your nodes to get transformed? So you put that logic inside the file and give it to JS Code Shift and point out the source and input path like src or something, and then you run it. It will give you status like what are the number of files processed. It can also capable of spawning multiple threads simultaneously to work with files. And then it also gives results like what are the different files that has been modified or unmodified or status. So that's why this becomes a de facto tool for running your code mods in your code bases. And then recast is a library created by Benjamin Newman. He's also from Facebook. So recast is actually an AST transformer library. So all the AST transformation logic, your node transformation, create, update, delete, are given by the recast library. So it is also a non-destructive pretty printer, which means it keeps your source code formatting intact. And then it is also generates source maps. So this is a high level overview of how your code mods will work. At the first stage, you have the parse stage, which is taken care by recast. And at the end of the parse stage, you get the ASTs created. And then you have the JS Code Shift coming into play for manipulate the nodes, find, create and update nodes. And then finally you print it back to the source code using recast library. Okay. So I give you an analogy, AST and DOM, right? Previously, now we're reinforcing the same with AST Explorer and JS Code Shift. You inspect the DOM using your browser and manipulate it with jQuery, right? You manipulate the DOM content by manipulating the jQuery, the nodes of your DOM. Similarly, you inspect AST with AST Explorer and manipulate it with JS Code Shift. So if you understand this one thing, you are an expert in code mods, you are expert in AST transforms. Okay, the last paradigm shift we are going to talk about is moving from ad hoc changes to reusable code mods. So every time you do large scale refactoring or large scale migrations with your code base, you cannot simply reuse the same thing or same kind of work to another code base or another project, right? So how your code mods address these kind of issues? So there is a tool called Code Mod CLI. It's written by Robert Jackson, who is the core maintainer of Ember.js framework. So anybody heard about Ember.js framework? Yeah, okay, cool. Vijay doesn't count here. Okay, so Code Mod CLI is actually a tool to scaffold and generate a project boilerplate for your code mods. You just say Code Mod CLI new project. It will give a project with all the batteries included for your code mods. You can directly go and type in your AST transform logic. And then it supports multiple transforms. What I mean by transforms here is just code mods. You can manage multiple code mods within a single project. And you can auto-generate documentation with examples, something like how the code is before and after change. Code Mod CLI helps you to generate automatically these type of documentation in README files. And then you can test your code mods. It comes with just test runner, I guess, you can compare the snapshots with your code mods, and then you can also publish your code mods to NPM, and you can give it to your other teams or other projects, or share with the community also. So let's revisit the new paradigms, what we have been talking about so far. So we moved from rejects pattern matching to AST transformations. We moved from manual grunt work and using JS CodeShift for automation. And then instead of doing ad hoc changes, we use CodeMod CLI for creating reusable code mods. And then finally, this eventually leads to from breaking changes to make changes with confidence, right? So if you want to know what are the different code mods available out there, so I put together an awesome list of code mods, which is having more than 200 plus code mods for various purposes, for various frameworks like React, Ember, Vue.js, Angular, Preact. And it is also used by companies like Facebook, Shopify, LinkedIn, Intercom and Square for their internal code base migrations or refactoring kind of work. And for a framework like Ember.js, code mods are the natural migration path, which means if you want to upgrade from one version to the next version of Ember, the core team itself will provide code mods by providing a clean migration path. How do I address breaking changes, or how do I address deprecations raised in the new versions? So there are more than 20 plus official code mods for Ember, and you run it with a tool called Ember CLI Update, which will automatically give you a list of code mods you can choose and run. And Freshworks love Ember code mods. Recently, we did a migration, large scale migration, by moving our test suits from Mocha.js to QInit. It is more than 5000 test cases and 100 plus code mods. And we did it in 2 weeks and 2 months. 2 weeks to get the tooling ready, like writing code mods, correcting all the use cases and edge cases, testing the code mods, publishing it, sharing it with the teams or squads. And then it just took 2 months for the entire migration work. We just run the code mods and run the tests and verify. So keep in mind that your test is always implied. So without tests, you're not supposed to run code mods. Okay. So imagine that if you do this same kind of work manually, so how much time it would have taken, right? So now see a demo of creating code mods. I'll walk through a simple example which we saw earlier. So the replacing the variable name part, right? So this is AST Explorer. So you have a lot of language support also apart from JavaScript. So what we need to do is we need to replace the variable declaration hello with world, right? So inspect the variable declaration node. You go into the variable declarator node and change the name to hello. This is what we need to do. So let's see how we can do this using JS CodeShift and AST Explorer. So you turn on the JS CodeShift transform. By default, you will get a default transform, which will basically, you know, reverse the identifier names. As you can see on the right, all your identifier names has been reversed. It just takes and reverses the names. So we'll remove this one and write our own AST transform logic. So basically it is replacing with a new node, actually the identifier. It's finding all the identifiers and it's replacing the path value name with world. Okay, so now you can see we're still making the mistake of not looking through the context. We are just finding all the identifiers, right? We should not do that. Instead, we need to find the variable declarator, because identifier comes for both your variable declarator and function declaration also. So you need to find the right type of node. So that is the first lesson in writing code mods. So I'm putting a filter here now with the identifier, saying that if my path name is equal to hello, then you replace or update the name. So now you get the right transform, right? So you can also do it differently. So I'm just updating the value here, path.value.name. So there is one more way to do that. So instead of finding identifier, you can also do it in a different way. So we'll see that. So you can also pass the filter directly in the find function instead of doing a separate filter here. So you can just say name hello, and again it will pick the right node. So now we are going to find the variable declaration node, so not the identifier node. So this is just a more advanced version, right? So the first one was more primitive. So now we are finding the right type of node. So instead of finding identifier, we are finding variable declarator. So which will fetch only the variable declarator nodes, not the identifier nodes. And again, see, it works the same. So with your variable declarators, so it is variable declarator, I guess. It's not variable declarators. And there is also one more shortcut way. We call something called collections in JS CodeShift, where you can directly find the variable declarators instead of using the generic find function, right? So the find function is generic. So here you can directly find variable declarators, and we also have helper methods. Just say rename to hello world. You can also write your own collections on like this. You can find the function declarators. You can also extend JS CodeShift with collections and path nodes, everything. This is the demo. So now you know that writing code mods is about finding the right type of nodes, right? So and the second thing is you manipulate the nodes. You create, build most of the time the nodes, or you update the nodes, or you remove the nodes. So for these things, I put together simple tools which will help you assist, you know, to find the right type of node. So one is a tool called AST Finder, which will give the find API, JS CodeShift find API, by looking at the source code. So if you say let variable, it also gives variable find declarators. And there is another tool called AST Builder, which will help you to write the right builder API with JS CodeShift. Just you have to just give the code. I'll show a demo. So now it's time for the last paradigm shift. Now we come to the climax. So we have seen a lot of tools, right, to write code mods. So about finding the right type of nodes and building nodes. So what if there is a tool which automatically does it for you? A tool which sees the source and destination code. So how your source code is going to change into destination code. By looking at these two codes, it will generate code mods automatically, right? So this is the tool which is called Jarvis, okay? So let's see a demo for that. So this is a default one. So you are replacing foo with foobar here. So this is the code mod for that. So it is, which is automatically created. So this is source code and the destination code. So Jarvis looks at both the source and destination code, identify what type of AST node we are working with, and just put the relevant find and replace APIs for them. So since this is a call expression, we are finding a call expression with the callee name foo and replacing with a new call expression, but the callee here is a member expression, so which is foo.bar. So anything with dot bar, as I said earlier, is a member expression, and this is the output. Okay, so it supports different type of node operations with something called opcode. So this is the replace node operation. You can also do remove, insert before. So this is the remove operation. You just have to remove it and insert before. So inserting the new code before the source code, and insert after. Okay, so Jarvis works under the assumption that it always tries to find and replace with new nodes. It does not write code mods like what humans we do, right? We just update the properties as we saw earlier. Just we are updating the value name, right? So let's see the same example with that. So I'm just going to replace the name with the world. So here you can see it just replaced a new declarator node. So instead of that, there is something called smart update, which will eventually do what we humans, how we will approach AST transforms. So like this. So instead of building new nodes, it just updates the node value. Okay. So we have seen what code mods are, how powerful they are. So what is the takeaway here? So the first takeaway is that we should be building transformation tools to make large scale refactorings, you know, which will eventually boost our confidence so that we don't introduce any breaking changes. All right. So the second takeaway is that code modifications with tools is greatly improve the way you evolve and maintain large scale code bases. It's very easy with code mods instead of doing everything with manual work or regex transforms. And thank you. So over to you, Vijay.
Vigar?
I think I finished before time, right?
You're fine, no
yeah,
problem.
Okay.
So we are opening it for the questions. Anyone? Questions?
Yes.
Hello. So I have two scenarios. The first one is let's say I have a config file, JSON file from which I am reading certain variables, and then I am creating the same variable inside a JS file. And the second scenario is let's say I have a karma test in which I am using the same variables that is inside the JS file, and I want to replace that variable. So in this both cases, will this work?
Okay, so you're saying that you're taking from a config file a variable name into a code file and then into the test file, correct?
Yeah, but the thing is there is a redundancy. So in a config file, let's say there is a variable name hello, okay, and it has some value, and in a JS file, I'm using the same variable name and assigning it to the same name variable.
Okay, your question is whether the code mods will touch the config file and the test files. No, it need not to, because you are pointing the right directory to them. So usually JS CodeShift works with JavaScript and TypeScript files. I'm sorry, TypeScript files. It always looks for extensions with .js and .ts. So your config files, if it is a different extension, it is safe, I guess.
But the karma, it won't work, right? Spec file.
If you want to run the code mods only for your source code files, you can just point out the source code directories alone. You don't have to point the entire root directory. You're getting me?
Yeah, but if I wanted to, because see, otherwise it's a pointless, because your karma.
Okay, you want to do it both in the test file.
Exactly.
Well. Yeah, then you can give the root directory, the top level directory for both your source and test files.
So,
or you can run it separately. It's up to you how you run the code mods.
No, the point is not how I run. The point is, if I want to do it, does the code mod understands the syntax of a karma file the way basically AST can render identifiers from the karma file?
Okay, your karma file is written in which language? Is it written JavaScript?
TypeScript?
Yeah, it will understand.
It will understand.
Yes, yes. See, the code mods and AST transforms works with any parser or compiler or transpiler like your Babel or TypeScript, which will just export three APIs. Like you have parse API, transform API, and generate API. So if the compiler or transpiler exports these three APIs and gives a solid AST spec, then your code mods can understand very well.